And here we are
at the priory.
And this is the cloister that we're at the moment. The cloister was the hub of daily life in the priory, comprised of four covered walls enclosing a central courtyard with a planted garden there. The 13th century cloister walks were richly decorated with sculpture. I'll get you closer in so you can read it all too. Edward I appears to have used the cloister as for exercise during his stay at Lanercost, 1306 to 1307. He gave instructions for the gutters to repair. So this is the cloister. And we have a blocked in arrow slip. Now what do we have here? Was this a toilet back in the day? Very possibly was. The top's been blocked off. Ooh, let's have a look inside here. Part of the arch has been covered up. Wow. And look how thick these walls are. That's about 4 foot thick. Let's go down here. Is this a fireplace, maybe? Possibly, looks that way. This fine 13th century room was originally divided into. The far chamber to the right was probably used for storage. And this end was a warming room with a large fire. So yeah, that's a fireplace. It's enormous. Look at these ceilings. Absolutely fabulous. Beautiful. Stones from Burdos Wood. These three stones were the foundation Burdos Wood fort, founded Burdos Wood, Roman fort, collected by the Howard family who bought Lanercost Priory in 1869. They are all reproductions of the originals now kept at Burdos Wood itself. Absolutely stunning. swallows are making a nest. I'll head back down this way. There was a room to the right that I missed. There's the cloister. I'm curious about what was in there. So we'll loop back round. Steps. Wow, look at those. The detail. This ornamented recess incorporated a line of basins in which the canons washed their hands before meals. Beautiful. Just look at that. We can actually go inside there too. I'm excited about that. Look at that doorway. What would have been a doorway? Wow. Balcony above and around. And that's the window we've been on the inside of that. It's the current modern day church. I wonder what these were. Gorgeous oak door. All around. Lanercost grave monuments. 21 grave monuments here at Lanercost Priory range from grave slabs dating from soon after the Priory's foundation to ornate memorials of the medieval Vaux family and the later Dacres and Howards. While some individual pieces are extremely significant as a group, they are of national importance. One is a 14th century tomb, chest of Robert de Vaux, whose castle was at Gilsland, which is about 15 miles away. Two and four, plain graves. Three, redstone grave. Here lies James Dacre Esquire, who died July the 16th, 1716, in the 30th year of his age, being the last male heir of the Dacres to Lanercost. So Humphrey Dacre died in 1508, and his wife Mabel died in 1510. there's an outstretched hand, allegedly part of a larger structure. 13, grave belonged to George James Howard, 9th Earl of Carlisle, and his wife Rosalind, Christopher Edward Howard, an effigy of George and Rosalind Howard's daughter, Elizabeth Dacre Howard, portrayed as a sleeping baby. She died at 4 months old on the 17th of July, 1883. Is Charles Wentworth George Howard and his wife Priscilla Harriet. Thomas, 2nd Lord of Dacre, and died in 1525 with his wife Lady Elizabeth, 1516. Charles James Stanley Howard, 10th Earl of Carlisle, died in 1912. A medieval effigy of a knight wearing a short tunic, reused and inscribed. John Crowe of Longlands died 23rd of March, 1708, aged 25 years. According to local legend, he broke his neck while climbing the ruins of the priory. Charles and Rhonda, the 10th Earl and Countess of Carlisle. And 21 is a grave cover bearing the inscription to the memory J.M. Mary Fawcett, wife of the Reverend M. Thomas Fawcett of this church, who died February 17, 1741, age 46. Let's look at this place. Why anyone would want to do that? So this is number one. It's been plastered at the back. And look at the detail in this masonry. It's got a coat of arms. Was it plastered or is it whitewashed? Oh, look at these beautiful vaulted ceilings. Wow, look at that. The stonework on these is absolutely amazing. Here we've got a sword on top of this one. I can make out. So I've got a sword and I've got a hand. Another beautiful carving. I'll stand back to get this in because it is amazing. Just look at the work on that. And it's still standing today. It's amazing. This is the one I went up before. Here lies James Dacre, who died July the 1716, the 30th year of his age, being the last heir of the Dacres at Lanercost. Now, this masonry work is unbelievable. Look at the detail. It's gone into that. And I've got a coat of arms. And the ropes on the bottom are just wow. Then we'll come round this way. That was at what I presume was a knight. Stood. Got a bit of a hand there. And then we've got an inscription around there. Look. Is that a lion? Is it a dog? It must be a dog. A dog with chainmail on. Fleur-de-lis. There we go. Another knight holding the coat of arms. Got griffins. Holding that coat of arms on that side. We've got an eagle. An inscription all the way around. And now we come through to this room. Oh, this one's marble. And this one is a 4-month-old little girl. Bless her heart. Incredibly sad, but incredibly beautiful. Looking at her, I'm expecting her arm to move. There's a heart. We don't have an inscription on. This is Mum and Dad. Hopefully you can see. We've got a sword. And we have Here Lies the Body of Charles Wentworth George Howard, born 27th of March 1814. And I think, was his mother called Mabel? Mary Priscilla Howard, his much loved wife. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Basin, water basin. George James Howard, Earl of Carlisle, 1843 to 1911, and his wife Rosalind Frances, daughter of the second Baron Stanley of Alderley, 1845 to 1921. They served their generation. Here we've got another marble. Christopher Edward Howard, born 1873, died September 1896. For so he giveth his beloved sleep. just wow. Read the information board. This is how this part of the church would have looked. So this is how we are now. The canons gathered daily to pray in the presbytery of the church. Their regular devotions included the celebration of the Mass and the so-called offices, a series of services that fell at intervals throughout day and night. From this superbly preserved ruin, it is still possible to understand the medieval arrangement of the interior. The presbytery occupied one of the four arms of the church, which was laid out on a cross-shaped plan. It was separated from the public nave, now the parish church, by a stone screen called a pulpitum. One section of this screen is today incorporated in the wall that divides the roofed ruins parts of the building. You can still see sockets of the masonry for the lost furnishings of the interior. The canons sat in wooden stalls facing one another across the building in the area immediately adjacent to the screen. Raised on three shallow steps at the far end of the church was the high altar. The church was covered with a timber roof. The drawing of around 1400 shows a church at Lanercost with a tall spire. There is no obvious surviving physical evidence of this feature. Part of the tomb of Lord Thomas, 1525, and Lady Elizabeth Dacre, as it might have appeared when its sculptor was painted. So this is where the altar would have been. Some more beautiful masonry. These windows are monsters. So again, there's the modern day church. And just look at this. Just look at the detail. Again, I nearly missed those. Stunning masonry. Eagle's sadly missing its head. And 1525, this is just stunning. Wow, those fish. And this, whoa. Looks like it was done yesterday. Look at this detail. The shells are beautiful. Richard James Stanley Howard, 10th Earl of Carlisle, on March 1867, died January 1892. Some acorns there. The Path of the Just. As a shining light that hymneth. His wife was a bit of an afterthought. She was just written on the sill. This one's too warm to tell. So there would have been your timber roof. Just wow. Night stairs. A flight of timber stairs here led to the dormitory on the first floor, allowing the canons to gain easy access to the church for their nighttime devotions. That ledge must have been the first floor, I would presume. Maybe not. Again, these walls are about 4 foot thick. And we've got some masonry work on either side. That's where a door would have hung. We've got a lot of foundations still in the ground. We've had a wall coming out here. And there again, you've got the wooden roof. More foundations. Well, let's go around. So much more of the building. Have a look at it on the plan. monastery and its conversion. Over the course of the Middle Ages, Lanercost Priory developed into a substantial and imposing monastic complex. The whole site was enclosed by a precinct wall. You know, it's all on the map there. Which was entered through a gatehouse number 2. That's where we come on from the road. Service buildings such as stables and barns were number 3. So that's the buildings over that way. Then we have nearby the north of the church stood a high stone cross erected 1214. To the south precinct there were ponds, number 5. So we have 4. That cross is still actually there. This is the modern day graveyard. So the fish ponds were right out that way. The priory was adapted for use during Edward I's prolonged visit in 1306-7. The king was an unwilling visitor, prevented by his final illness from marching north to lead an army into Scotland. There is documentary evidence that a chamber was erected for his use, and this probably stood within the wider precinct. The monastery must have been overwhelmed by the efforts of the king's visit and the need of his royal entourage. At the dissolution of the priory in 1537, the monastic buildings were converted into a grand residence by Thomas Dacre. He pulled down the cloister walks and the eastern monastic range that housed chapter house and dormitory. At the same time, the west range and service court were reorganised and set with towers in the fashion of a castle. With the exception of the north aisle, the church roof was stripped and the building left as an empty shell. So this was the building after the conversion into a house. Imagine this being a house. Absolutely unbelievable. I'll go back down and go over this way. I mean, this was simply huge. What's this building? I think we've been in here. No, we haven't. That's a shame, the big arches have gone. You can see the pillars where they would have sat. All the way along. Look at this. No, I've got a bit of a gutter there. And we've had a doorway there on that first floor. You can see where the building's been added. Is that a fire, I presume? we've had a fireplace here. So that was the first floor. And I had a fire. Let's have a look. The kitchen and Dacre Tower. It's a kitchen. This tower was probably built by Thomas Dacre during the conversion of the priory into a residence during the 1550s. With its crown of battlements, the tower intended to bring the prestigious character of a castle to this new residence. From the evidence of the fabric, it is possible to see how the old monastic kitchen was ingeniously converted into a tower. In its final form, the tower was a four-story structure. At the first floor, there was a large fireplace, and in each corner behind you, there remains a domed oven. Ah, so they're ovens. So number one, we've got the side of the fireplace, which is there. Is it? No, it's not here. Number two is the first floor level, all around. Number three is the second floor. So the second floor started where that blocked up doorway is. And number four, that was a spiral staircase. So these were ovens in the corners. Just look at those windows. Is massive. It's a swallow goes up there. No, not yet, in the car yet. We'll have a look there. Beautiful building. So that's the first floor through there. Is the chimney all blocked? Pretty much. And it goes higher than I thought it would. Enormous fire. So this must be where the duck ponds, fish ponds are, or were. So we've had two walls come out there. An archway. And again through here. What a beautiful building. Steps. Just gorgeous. So this would have been a garden. An exercise yard. Oh, lovely apple pear tree. Look around here. It's amazing masonry. She genuinely just looks like she's asleep. Fabulous carving. But that one is out of this world. I'd love to get up on that balcony, really would. So here we go. So against the window is 19. Medieval 13th century effigy of a knight wearing a short tunic. That was reused. 17, Thomas, 2nd Lord of Dacre, 1525. Which is that fabulous one there. So, thank you all for watching. Looking outside. I wonder what they were. Thank you all for watching. I'll catch you next time.